So we've looked at the Big Bang and how our universe started. We said that everything started out in one small little spot, and then it started a rapid expansion, and eventually that expansion couldn't contain itself and it threw matter all over the universe. And as that matter started to clump together, it started to form some areas that were a little bit more dense, which started to create their own gravity, which started to pull into some more matter. And then from there, we went on to how was the sun created. And we talked about the nebula and how the gases in the center of the nebula started to collide with one another and they started to compress under the weight of gravity, and that started fusion. But what we didn't talk about was all the stuff that was left over, because not everything in the nebula became the star. And so there's usually some stuff that was left over, unless you have. Especially for your smaller stars, it didn't have enough gravity to pull all that matter from the nebula into the star. And that's where we get our planetary systems or our solar systems, because some of that stuff is left and it becomes this ring of material. So you have what kind of looks like a frisbee with a bump in the middle of it. And so you have this big cloud of gas and dust where the center of it starts to become a star. And you get your protostar in the middle before fusion has started, and you've got this disk around the outside of it that's made up of all this other stuff that's left over. It's all these other elements. So the heavier elements start to get pulled towards the center, where the center of gravity is, and that's where they can stay. Kind of, it stays the warmest, and so only the things that can become a solid at a higher temperature will stay towards the center. And that's how our planet started to become. So all this other stuff out there became our planets. So we have little bits and pieces that start running into one another. It's called collision. So we talked about collision coalescence when we talked about rain being formed and how the water molecules would crash and stick together. Exact same thing is happening here. It's called accretion. That disk around it is called an accretion disk. So you've got all our little particles. And all our little particles are excited. They're moving around. There's gravity that's pulling on one another, and they start to run into one another. And that's where the physical collision happens. And these are called planetesimals. They're the little bits and pieces. There's little building blocks of our planets. And then our planetesimals start to run into one another, and they crash and stick, okay, through accretion to one another. And that's where we get our protoplanets. Our protoplanets are smaller. The protoplanets start to run into one another also, and that's where we get our planets from. So our planets that are our inner planets, they were formed of the heavier metals and things like that that once again could stay solid at a warmer temperature. The things that and then our gas giants on the outside of our asteroid belt are made up of our lighter elements. So, the kind of cool thing about our outer planets that are made up of our gases is that Jupiter did not form from the physical collision of particles. It formed from gases coming together just like the Sun did. But the difference, the biggest difference between Jupiter and the Sun is size. And because it wasn't big enough, it could never actually be a star. So, it didn't have enough pressure pushing in on it to actually start the process of fusion, but Jupiter was formed in the same process that stars were, so which is kind of cool, but it will always be a planet. It will never be a star. So our inner planets or our terrestrial planets are solid. They're mostly made up of rocks and metals, and our outer planets are mainly made up of gases. So because Jupiter's so big, it does have a much stronger gravitational pull than some of our other planets do. And we'll talk about that a little bit more when we talk about characteristics of our planets. So our sun, which formed in the center of our accretion disk, has three basic regions. And this is very similar for all of our stars, especially our medium stars that are the same size as the sun. So we have three basic regions. We have a core, we have an inner zone, and we have an atmosphere. The core obviously being in the center, this is where fusion is actually happening, and everything else around it is happening because that fusion is happening in the core. So in our inner areas, we have our radiative zone, And then we get outside of that, where we get our atmosphere, where we have our chromosphere, our photosphere, and our corona. So that convective zone, convection, once again, remember, is that movement of warmer to colder, right? So convection happens in the sun just like it does in the water on the planet, in the atmosphere on the planet, and in the mantle on the planet. So the core is about a tenth of the diameter. You can see the temperature here. That's pretty hot. Okay, that's in Celsius, which means that in Fahrenheit it would be higher. And once again, that's where fusion is happening. Our radiative zone and our inner zones. So this is where it's around the core. When we talk about the different wavelengths of light and what we can see, okay, we know this because we can see different things that are emanating from the sun. We can't actually see the radiative zone or the convective zone because they're underneath the atmosphere. So we have energy that's moving by electromagnetic waves or energy that's moving by convection. Once we get to our outer layers, now we have the parts that we can see. So the photosphere is the deepest part of the sun that we can actually see. The gases come up from the convective zone, and that's where they start to shine, if you will. And that's the deepest part that we can see. It looks kind of grainy if you look at it through a special filtered telescope. Please don't look at the sun. So the chromosphere is our next layer. It's kind of where we get reddish light. This picture right here is a corona. This is during an eclipse. And if you've ever looked during an eclipse, you can use like a special pinhole camera, or there are special little filters that you can buy, so you can look directly at the sun and then you can see the corona. The neat thing about it during the eclipse is you'll be able to see some of the things we'll talk about next, which are solar flares and prominences you can see during the eclipses, because usually there's so much light coming out of the sun that even with the filters, with your naked eye, it's sometimes hard to see some of the stuff that's going on. But during the eclipse, it blocks out the majority of that light. And so all we're seeing is the stuff that's coming off of the sun. So we're seeing the energy that's coming out of the sun. So solar wind is what escapes the gravitational pull. And it's not like in a big shot or anything like that. It's just the energy that's leaving. It skips off of our atmosphere and off of our electromagnetic shield, if you will, because our planet is spinning and because we have that iron and nickel in our core. It actually generates a magnetic field around Earth, which helps to protect us from the solar wind, which is a good thing. If you're near the polar regions, where it kind of skips off the edges, that's where we get the aurora borealis, which is the northern lights. You can also get the southern lights as well, but they're really cool, and it's just that interaction between the solar wind and between our atmosphere. The solar flares that I was talking about before are where energy is kind of actually shot out from the side. You'll have areas where there's larger amounts of activity in the surface of the sun, and it'll kind of shoot energy out. It'll shoot particles out from the sun, and that's what this is right here. The part that's coming back down is the prominence. The part that goes out is the solar flare, and it releases energy towards the sun. Solar flares, if they're big enough, can actually mess up some of our electronics. They can mess up satellites. But for the most part, solar flares are kind of small and they're not that big of a thing. Light only takes about 7 minutes to get from the sun to Earth, so if it's a giant solar flare, we don't have much warning. That's coming. There's really nothing we can do about it. So sunspots happen in a cycle. You're going to learn a lot more about sunspots in the activity this week. But here are sunspots. They're darker activities. They're cooler areas on the surface of the sun. A lot of times you'll have activity that goes from one sunspot to the next, because it's differences in electric charges. Excuse me. So, and once again, we talked about solar flares. This is a prominence. So a prominence is that material is ejected, but it actually gets pulled back down by gravity back towards the surface of the sun. So it doesn't actually leave. Once again, usually these are oppositely charged areas on the sun. So one has a positive charge, one has a negative charge. And so it's kind of like electricity that's flowing through it. Just like we have electricity that flows through our plugs and stuff like that in our electrical cords.